My castaway this week is artist and writer Quentin Blake. For more than 50 years, his work as an illustrator has brought to life the characters and fantastical happenings in some of our most treasured children's books. His style is, in itself, almost a definition of childhood: exuberant, subversive, chaotic, and spirited. Drawings with a degree of innocent optimism that can be almost painfully touching, but never sickly sweet. Quentin Blake, it's almost impossible to imagine books like James and the Giant Peach or the BFG without the drawings that seem to have sprung from your pen. Is it a pen you use when you're drawing?
It's mostly a pen I use. I use an assortment of things. What I like best is a scratchy pen. It's an old-fashioned writing pen, and it's called a Waverly nib. And you can feel it when you're drawing, you know, you can feel the shapes that you're making. That's what I mostly use, but I mean, as I get older and do it more often, I sometimes use reed pens or I use a quill. A few years ago, I was given a vulture's wing feather and I thought this would make a marvellous quill. So I cut it and drew vultures with it. And since then, I've been getting parrot's feathers to draw parrots with and swan's feathers to draw swans with. But they're wonderfully scratchy things. And the fact that they're a little bit unreliable and you're not quite sure what they're going to do, that makes it more exciting. You've got to be on your toes.
I read once that you drew something with a Boots toothpick. I presume that's not true.
Oh, no, that's absolutely true. Yes. No, I'd forgotten about that. It's before I knew about quills. It was the first Punch cover that I ever did, but that was before I discovered the joys of real quills from real birds.
Have you always drawn? Is there a sense in which you're sort of compelled from some sort of inward force to get it out on paper?
Well, I suppose so. I mean, with hindsight. I mean, when I was a small boy, I just used to draw because I liked doing funny drawings. You know, and I didn't think that it was drawing or drawing was a special activity. And then it was later on that I realised that what I really liked was drawing. I mean, jokes were fine, you know, kind of thing. But what I really liked was drawing the things in the pictures.
Looking at your pictures, there's a sense that they've almost run onto the page and slapped themselves on there, that that's where they've stopped. There's a lot of energy. So were you a little boy with a lot of hijinks? Was there mischief in you?
No, this is vicarious. I mean, this is instead. You know, I mean, the pictures are full of people running about and jumping and dancing, something I do very badly indeed if I ever do it. And no, I can imagine those things happening, and I actually kind of mime them when I'm drawing them. And I know, I mean, I've been told I make the faces of the people in the pictures, but it's not what I actually do in life. I can do it in drawings, but I don't expect me to be doing anything too energetic.
We're going to talk in a minute a bit more, I hope, about the little Quentin Saxby Blake. But let's hear before that your first piece of music.
I'm a sort of musical illiterate, so I'm one of these people who only knows what I like. But this is a piece of Janáček's quartet, Intimate Letters, which is, when I discovered Janáček, I suppose it was when I was a student, I thought it was wonderful because it sounds like what drawing feels like.
Thank you.
the opening of Janáček's second string quartet, Intimate Letters, played by the Praja Quartet. Quentin Blake, then, you were born just before Christmas in 1932, the son of William and Evelyn. You had a bigger brother, but he was 10 years older, so quite
That's
removed.
Right. We were like two only children, in a way, really.
And was it a house full of energy and art and paint and nibs and creativity?
No. No, I don't think so. I mean, we did have a visitor to the house, and I learnt about this afterwards, and somebody wrote a letter to someone in the family saying, well, you're going to see Quentin. He doesn't talk very much, but he draws a lot.
So you were this quiet little boy in a pebble-dashed semi in Kent, with your bedroom looking out down the garden onto the railway line.
That's not bad, yes, that's I think that's right, yes.
And then the war comes. What happens when the war comes?
You start collecting shrapnel. you sort of carry on. I mean, there is an air raid shelter in the garden, and I think I can once remember seeing bombs dropping out of an aeroplane, and I can remember being at a party, strangely, a birthday party or something like that, where you could see the red glow of the fires in East London, that which was the Blitz.
So we've established then, Quentin, that the need to draw started early. You were, by all accounts, pretty gifted individual, but the schoolmasters had a different idea about where your future lay.
Well, traditionally they did, because it wasn't the sort of school where you did art very much. You were allowed to do it. I mean, there's a great tradition of that, you know, but chaps who are not very bright are allowed to do art or woodwork sort of thing.
But you were a bright chap.
Well, I was quite bright. I mean, I could do the other exams. But, I mean, what I wanted to do was be left alone to draw something, you know, get on with drawing something. I remember there was an art master there who was obviously had to get people to draw who didn't like drawing, and he got you to do wild, wandering lines, you know, and then you had to look at it and see what you... And I could only ever make octopuses out of it. But in the sixth form, I was taught by a man called Stanley Simmons, who was a real painter, and who's only just died recently. And he really talked to you like a serious artist and told you what you had done. And that was where I began to get some sort of basis.
Your second piece of music.
The second piece of music is part of Ravel's piano concerto, not the one for the left hand, the one in G major, but it's got that sort of wonderful spirit of poise and vivacity and energy, which I admire in a lot of French music.
The opening of Ravel's piano concerto in G major, played by Zoltán Kocsis. The next record that we're going to hear in just a moment was released in 1949. Something extraordinary happened to you in 1949, which was, as a 16-year-old, you had your first work published in Punch. You must have been the youngest person ever to draw for Punch.
Well, actually not. There was somebody else, actually, in the 19th century, who was Dickie Doyle, who was a man I admired enormously.
And how old was he?
He was 16 as well, I think. You know, but no, I've still got the letter from the art editor, which in handwriting at the bottom says, "Congratulations to the youngest contributor."
Right.
That was terribly important for me. I can still remember getting that letter standing at the bottom of the stairs, you know, where the letters arrived, kind of thing. They were terrible drawings, really. I mean, you know, I could draw well enough to get the joke across, to get it into the paper, and they were very small drawings, but that got me started.
It takes quite a lot of steel for a 16-year-old to be sending his drawings to Punch. Where did you get that self-determination?
Well, I actually sent drawings for 2 years before anything was accepted, and at the end, I wrote rather pathetically saying, I've been sending these drawings in for 2 years, could I bring some in? And in fact, I did go to Punch office, which was very grand in those days. It was like a London men's club, you know, with chaps in suits. And I sat in the waiting room and the secretary gave me some copies of The New Yorker, I think, or something like that. And I was sitting there reading those next to a woman who eventually disappeared. And then she came back after about half an hour and said, oh, are you still here? We thought you were with that lady who was and I had to go back another day. But anyway, but they were very nice to me, and that's when they took two of these little drawings.
If we were to leaf through some of those 1949 editions of Punch, would we recognise the drawings as notably Quentin Blake drawings?
You might do. They were quite economical, but you might recognise them, but it's that way of drawing, which I now know people recognise, happened really when I was 20-something. And gradually I relaxed. And in fact, if you're relaxed, you draw much better because you're thinking about what that is, what that gesture is that that person is making. You're not thinking about, am I going to spoil it, you know, which is the important thing, I think.
At the same time, then, that you are beginning to have small but significant success with your drawings, in school they are coaching you, hothousing you, because they think you're bound for Cambridge and great things.
Yes, I don't know about the great things, but certainly...
Well, insofar as you're the first, there's a small group of boys who are being coached to go on to the big
right,
university.
You're quite right, but very few people at that time did go to Oxford or Cambridge from our school, or indeed from any schools except private schools, I think.
And you were the first in your family to even go to university, is that right?
Yeah, I think so, yes.
What did your parents make of this journey and this... You seem to be playing it down. Did they play it down, or were they congratulating you at getting into university?
I think oh, no, they were pleased. They were pleased about that. I don't think they had quite the sense of what it meant, really, I think. You know, I mean, I think they were pleased for me. And, of course, having passed through the 30s, which was a difficult time for employment, I mean, they were anxious that my brother and I should have reliable jobs. You would think of that as being in the civil service or in a bank or something like that, or being a teacher. And in fact, it was a teacher that I went through with that experience.
And so for them, you going to Cambridge meant that that was a solid chance, in fact, of your life being a comfortable, reliable, straightforward life.
I think so, yes.
Your next piece of music?
The next piece of music is, it's really a bit to do with Cambridge. When I got to Cambridge, I started to learn a bit more about music. And this is a song by John Dowland, In Darkness, Let Me Dwell. And it seems, for me, it will, as I'm listening to it, it gathers up both the sense of reading Shakespeare, of being at Cambridge, of encountering new kinds of music. And so it takes me back to that time, as well as being, I think, you know, very good to listen to now as well.
Darkness, let me
countertenor Alfred Deller singing John Dowland's In Darkness Let Me Dwell. So Quentin Blake, in 1953, it's off to university and all the things we associate with that. Did you start really having a good time?
I started having a good time in one way, because I was reading a lot of books, but I wasn't, it was curious. I think I was rather, we were at a rather serious college, at least I felt one ought to be serious. And so I didn't do a lot of things by way of parties and theatricals and things of that kind. I think I was probably regarded as a bit of a disappointment as a student in that department.
So that was all going on around you, but in a sense you were much more self-contained.
Well, I inhibited, I think, is probably what I'm trying
yes,
to say.
Thank you for saying that.
but it was very valuable to me, and I liked it. I started going to life classes at the art school. I art edited one or two issues of Granta, which in those days was the student magazine. But I didn't quite feel I was part of that world entirely. It may be that there were, you know, a lot of public school boys there, and I was a grammar school boy, or maybe I didn't quite make that transition. And in a sense, I suppose, when I came to teach at the Royal College of Art later on, I was more, I caught up on some of the, as it were, student life that I'd rather neglected when I was at Cambridge.
Interesting. We might explore that later. The plan, though, while you were at Cambridge...
Not too far.
The plan when you were at Cambridge, then, was to study, to go on to teach. I mean, teaching for you, did you have any passion for teaching, or was it just a case of needs must, and you knew that at the end there needed to be a job, and that job seemed appropriate to be teaching?
No, I really wanted to do it. I mean, I'm passionate about it, actually. I went on to do a teaching year at London University School of Education. And in fact, curious enough, while I was doing that year, I was offered a job as assistant art director on Punch.
Quite a grand job to be offered.
And I turned it down.
Why on earth did you turn it down?
Well, I think I already thought that Punch wasn't where I was going, really. I was getting out of jokes, and I wanted to get... I mean, somewhere in me, I wanted to be a book illustrator, you know, kind of thing.
And was that defined in your head at that point?
It was... Yeah, I think it was, actually. I think, I mean, not well defined, but I think it was growing there. And I mean, it was rather funny when I turned down the job, and you know, and then of course, as one does, you know, I got cold feet the next day and rang up and said, "Oh, what happens if I change my mind?" They said, "We've appointed somebody else." So, but I mean, it was a relief, really. But it's very strange how you come to do right things sometimes, because I was actually right not to take that job, you know, because I didn't want to become that kind of art director. I wanted to be an artist in my own right, really, I think, you know.
Many might have thought at the time that turning down a job like that at a well-established publication like Punch was madness. In a sense, you're saying there was an instinct that was flying in the face of reason and flying in the face of what Mum and Dad had always said, which was something solid, a good career, something that will give you an income. Has that been a theme? Are you quite an instinctual creature?
Well, I don't know. I think everybody is, but I think I am to some extent. I mean, I think there are instincts that direct you, and there was one that took me to Chelsea Art School, which was the next stage, because I'd read about a man called Brian Robb, who was both a painter and a cartoonist and an illustrator, and I was looking for somewhere where I could go and do life drawing, because I knew that I just didn't know enough to draw the things I wanted to draw. And I discovered he was teaching at Chelsea, and I went there. And that I got myself there, in retrospect, is a kind of miracle, because, he actually changed the rest of my life.
Fourth piece of music.
The next piece of music is one of the sea interludes from Benjamin Britten's Peter Grimes, and I like it because it's got that sense of flatness and water that I associate with the marshes that I spend a lot of my time in. Thank you.
That was Dawn, one of the sea interludes from Benjamin Britten's Peter Grimes. So, Quentin Blake, then you had graduated from university, you'd done your teacher training. Did life after that start to open up a bit? I mean, where were you living? What was the day-to-day existence?
Yeah, I got a little regular job with Punch, and in those days that meant £10 a week, and I lived with my parents for a while.
So back at home after university?
Yes, that's right.
How was that?
I didn't like it very much. I mean, I didn't like it because I liked them, if you see what I mean. So it was harder to rebel. But eventually I went and lived in a flat in London, and the work built up.
You mentioned that you joined the Royal College of Art, and in the 70s, the awards, big awards, start to come in. You're at the Royal College of Art. It seems to me that life then started, the jacket started to fit a bit better. You started to expand as a person in terms
yes.
of the life you were living.
Yes. No, it was wonderful in two ways. I mean, Brian Robb, who I'd known at Chelsea, went to the RCA and taught illustration there, and he said to me, you wouldn't like a part-time job here, would you? You know, and I thought about that for about 5 seconds, you know, and said yes without knowing what I was saying yes to. Actually, I thought it would be a very part-time job, you know, a sort of humble role where you crept in once or twice a week. But in fact, of course, the department had 30 students, but it only had 3 tutors. And so, you became a pillar of that department immediately, you know. And a lot of my friends are, you know, were students at the ex-students. Well, I mean, they were postgraduate students, you know, and I was 30-something, they were 20-something. So the distance wasn't huge, you know, and I still know lots of them.
Your next piece of music, Quentin, then, is very different from the first four that we've heard, and it hints at something of the looseness that you... I mean, I get the impression you're almost living your student life at this point in time.
There was an element of that, I think. This is not a kind of music I really know anything about, but if I wanted to be reminded of a party at the RCA, I mean, any of those parties at the RCA in the late 60s and 70s, this would do it for me. I think it's I heard it through the grapevine.
Marvin Gaye and I heard it through the grapevine, bringing back Quentin Blake memories of those parties in the late 60s and 70s at the Royal College of Art. Let's examine for a moment this curious process, and opaque to those of us on the outside, process of collaboration between the writer and the illustrator. I mean, you've worked with some of the greatest names. We will come on to talk about one of the greatest in a moment, but people like Michael Rosen, Joan Aitken. How does the collaboration work?
Well, it's fascinating because, I mean, sometimes people say to you, you know, you must enjoy doing your own work best, you know, but really I like collaborating with people. And what you do, first of all, is you collaborate with what they've written. So you read it intensely and you read it several times and you try and get the atmosphere of what that is. And then you do some drawings and try and draw what you feel is there and where it should go and which bits you should draw. And really, it's after that that you talk to the author, I think, and then that gives them a chance. It's no good saying, what shall I draw? You know, I mean, you have to make your commitment to it.
It's fair to say that, I mean, you are thought to be up there with the greats, to be up there with Shepherd and Tenniel. The match that was made in heaven and the moment at which people seem to absolutely stand back and take notice is the marriage between you and Roald Dahl. How did it begin?
Well, he moved from his previous publisher to Jonathan Cape, and the director of Jonathan Cape was Tom Mashler. And I think he'd suggested to Roald that he would write a picture book, which he'd never done before, and he wrote The Enormous Crocodile. And then I was one of the people that was suggested to illustrate it.
You've said about the Enormous Crocodile that the actual crocodile's teeth were teeth for eating children with.
Oh, yes.
And that, in a sense, chimes beautifully so often with what we read in Roald Dahl, which is this sense of things not just hinting at terror, but absolutely screaming with
yes,
terror.
Yes, yeah, well, I mean, he says in the text, the teeth rattled, you know. Well, I mean, crocodile's teeth don't. And I thought it was a sort of cross between a Punch and Judy crocodile and Richard III, sort of thing. I mean, is that kind of embodiment of evil? I mean, the book is the guide. The book is always the guide, but it leads you to find things which you mightn't have found otherwise.
The first time that you worked with Darwin, there was a sort of a beauty contest to see if you were going to get the work.
I think so, yes. I never knew and I never asked, but at that time I had an American agent who said other people had been asked.
Right. Yeah. But it changed from simply the beauty contest and him taking the box and saying, this chap seems the right chap, to actual collaboration, which started on the BFG, the Big Friendly Giant.
Well, really, I mean, the BFG, it really worked better in a way because it went wrong slightly in that it's a much longer book. And I think everybody except Roald thought that it was going to have a scattering of illustrations, you know, rather different from the two previous ones. And it was actually at the printers, you know, and I'd done a dozen or so drawings. He'd approved of the drawings, but he was horrified to discover there were only these. So over that weekend, I did chapter heading drawings for the 23 chapters, whatever it is, and delivered them after the weekend. I'm feeling quite pleased with them, and I got it done. And the next day they rang up and said, he's still not happy. And we started again.
But you're laughing now. I mean, after 2 days of concerted effort to get all those chapter headings done, did you laugh at the time?
I don't know whether I laughed at the time.
Cried, possibly.
Probably, no. I gritted my teeth, I expect. You know. But we did start again. I mean, and it's very difficult to talk about it not with hindsight, in a way, because, you know, Roald made a list of things. These are the things I think we ought to draw. And that was when I started going down to Great Missenden and taking the drawings. And you weren't just sort of a little sort of salad or parsley added to it afterwards with no effect.
You were integral to it.
You were integral to it, you know, and he needed that. He wanted that.
Tell me about the Big Friendly Giant's shoe.
Oh, the big... Well, I drew what Roald had written in the text, and he said the BFG, the Big Friendly Giant, he wore a big leather apron and boots, you know, sort of Wellington boots. I drew that. And, of course, he mentions it. He doesn't mention it again in the book, but I draw it, and I draw it in every wretched picture, of course, you know. And after a few of these, Roald said, I don't like this apron much. It gets in the way, doesn't it, you know, when he's to run and jump up and down and that sort of thing. And we went back and redesigned what he was going to wear and thought all that through. We got it all worked out, but we couldn't do the shoes. And so I went off home, and a bit later, this very strange kind of brown paper parcel, obviously made by Roald himself, arrived, and it's got this big sandal in it. And if you look in the book, you can see it.
Yes.
You know, I mean, that's what he's wearing. I think doing it twice, which effectively what I did, was like cooking something twice. You know, I think the flavours got better.
Your sixth record.
The sixth record is, well, it comes from that time, or really a bit before it. And I just thought, in relation to the desert island, it might be nice to have a hint of memory of the weather back home. So this is Flanders and Swan, who I remember seeing on the stage in the 50s and 60s. And this is very terse and to the point. It's a song of the weather.
January brings the snow, makes your feet and fingers glow. February's ice and sleet, freeze the toes right off your feet. welcome March with wintry wind. Would thou wert not so unkind? April brings the sweet spring showers, on and on for hours and hours. Farmers fear unkindly May, frost by night and hail by day. June just rains and never stops, 30 days and spoils the crops. In July the sun is hot, is it shining? No, it's not. August cold and dank and wet, brings more rain than any yet. Bleak September's mist and mud is enough to chill the blood. Then October adds a gale, wind and slush and rain and hail. Dark November brings the fog, should not do it to a dog. Freezing wet December then, bloody January again.
Flanders and Swan, a song of the weather to remind you on the desert island of just how bad it can be back in England, Quentin Blake. In 1999, you were appointed the first Children's Laureate, which sounds like a grand title. What did it mean, and was it important to you at the time?
It was important to me. I mean, before it happened, I thought, oh, that sounds, who's going to take a notice of somebody called Children's Laureate? You know, it sounded rather sort of self-conscious. But of course, once they said, we've chosen you, my attitude changed immediately.
You suddenly thought it was a wonderful idea.
I suddenly thought it was a wonderful idea. Well, the great thing about it is that Laureate badge meant you could do all kinds of things that I wouldn't have presumed to ask to do. I thought, it'd be quite nice to have some children's book illustrations in the National Gallery. And so we did a show called Tell Me a Picture, which had children's book illustrations, contemporary paintings, modern paintings, and works of the old masters, and hung them alphabetically, so none was raised above the other, if you see what I mean.
And in this exhibition, B was not for Blake, but Blake was everywhere in it. Explain how you made your presence felt.
There was an honest man called Michael Wilson, who at that time was director of exhibitions at the National Gallery. He said, we can only have one artist for each letter of the alphabet. So I said, well, there's a bit of a problem about B then. Is it me or Botticelli or Bruegel or something? He said, no, you're not in it at all. He said, but there's a lot of room on the wall. You could draw on the walls. And I said, are you allowed to do that? And he said, we want it to look as little like the National Gallery as possible. And so I drew between the pictures, and I hope they introduced you to the pictures rather than put you off.
Right, Quentin Blake, your next record.
The next one is, well, it's going back to this business of drawing, and this is Dvořák's cello concerto, and it's played by Casals, who again plays it, as I say, as though he was playing it with some wonderfully scratchy implement.
Thank you.
Pablo Casals playing part of Dvorak's Cello Concerto in B minor. Quentin, you've been drawing and writing for children for 46 years. Has what they want changed?
Do you know, I don't know. The first book I ever did, I tried out in an infant school, and I've never tried them out since. And I mean, obviously, I think about them, and, you know, and I'm trained as a teacher, and I, you know, I have some sense of the audience. But what I thought when I started was, I'll do this, and if they like it, I'll go on doing it.
A reviewer once remarked that your books often feature what they described as a solitary, perhaps slightly eccentric character attempting to cope with whatever degree of success. Might that hint at you?
No.
I hope I'm not being rude.
No. I'm coped magnificently.
Your eighth record.
The eighth record, it comes out of another experience which I had last year when I was asked to put on an exhibition, rather like the National Gallery one, at the reopening of the Petit Palais Museum in Paris. And I did huge drawings on the walls to introduce 19th century paintings and prints of women. And I also did a book of French verse for my French publisher. And one of the poems in it is a poem or song by Georges Brassens called Le Parapluie, the umbrella. And it seemed just right. I went out of the Petit Palais one day, was lucky enough to get in a taxi, got into the taxi, and this was playing on the radio.
Il pleuvait fort sur la grande route, elle cheminait sans parapluie. J'en avais un volé sans doute, le matin même à un ami. Courant alors à sa rescousse, je lui propose un peu d'abri, en séchant l'eau de sa frimousse. D'un air très doux, elle m'a dit oui. Un petit coin de parapluie contre un coin de paradis, elle avait quelque chose d'un ange. Un petit coin de paradis contre un coin de parapluie, je ne perdais pas au change, pardi. Chemin faisant, que ce fut tendre, d'où ira de le chant joli, que l'eau du ciel faisait entendre sur le toit de mon parapluie. J'aurais voulu, comme au déluge, voir sans arrêt tomber la pluie pour la garder sous mon refuge, 40 jours, 40 nuits. Un petit coin de parapluie contre un coin de paradis, elle avait quelque chose d'un ange. Un petit coin de paradis contre un coin de parapluie, je ne perdais pas au change, pardi.
Wonderful stuff. Georges Brassens and Le Parapluie. One would imagine that on this desert island, solitude might not be too much of a problem. It's a solitary profession that you've worked at for all these years.
Yes, but I like going out to talk to friends and editors and complaining and things of that kind. So it might not be so easy, but I shall do my best.
Now you have, of course, the Bible and the complete works of Shakespeare. One more book is allowed. What would it be?
I don't know, perhaps the... Oh, it's very difficult. Collected poems of Lord Byron, the collected poems of Alexander Pope, or perhaps if there's a big volume with a lot of Dickens in it, that's probably what I would have to settle for.
Right, we'll give you that. Your luxury item.
Well, that again is a problem, because what I really want is an everlasting supply of Arsh watercolour paper. But of course I don't regard that as a luxury. It's what is,
you know, would.
It's a necessity. But if you could fix it for me, I would accept that.
Right, so that's your luxury item. And if the waves were to sweep away your collection of music, which one would you run through the sand to save?
Maybe Janáček.
Quentin Blake, thank you very much for letting us hear your Desert Island Discs.
Thank you.